It's Offside with Hawes and McGuire.
There we are.
Hey. Hey.
Welcome to Offside with Hawes and McGuire. I'm Hawes.
I'm McGuire.
All right. Today we are trying something a little bit different. We are, I know, it's, you know what? I don't know what it is. I seem to spill
your,
alcohol.
It
all
senses,
the time.
It picks up your energy. And your,
it's effervescence. It's my effervescence.
Yeah. That, it's like that every fiber of your being is saying, explode.
No. Oh, I explode. I've had a few moments of explosion. We're trying something a little different today. We're going to do this as a fireside chat.
And it's beautiful.
It's a fireside
man.
Chat.
I love it.
We're doing this.
We just keep moving around your home.
Absolutely.
I just love it.
We have some things to talk about, though.
Yeah.
We got, this has been it's actually a pretty busy week with things happening.
I'll tell you, can't go 7 days.
We go 7 days.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah. So we had 7 days, kind of like the, you know, what we. It's actually great if you go 7 days. That's what I'm saying. What I'm saying is we do it right.
Right.
Yeah. So first thing I want to talk about, and I know it's not number one on your list of things to talk about. I want to talk about the Gauthier comments. We're going to start with that because that's right off, it's topical, it's off the top, and it's inflammatory, which is good.
Yes. So, straight up our alley.
So why don't I leave that to you? So let's explain to the viewers who may not know what's going on. Okay. What was said and the background.
Yeah. Well, Cutter Gauthier, high draft pick, just won a gold medal, actually voted top forward in the World Juniors for the Americans, largely because Canada were missing seven players. But leave that for another time. However, I think I covered that off last show.
Yeah.
Cutter Gauthier was drafted by the Philadelphia Flyers. Fifth or sixth overall, 2022. Proud to be drafted by the Flyers. Said he couldn't wait. At the time. Couldn't wait to be a Philadelphia Flyer. All vim and vigor. He's actually born in Sweden.
Okay, but, was it right?
American citizen now.
Okay.
And I probably could exercise both. I don't know. But regardless, fact is that he seemed to indicate, like every other draft pick, Chris, Not since the beginning of time, because others like Mary Lemieux or Eric Lindross and others weren't happy on draft day either.
Right.
But this guy gave every indication he was happy. And then at some point, still to be determined exactly, not that it matters, over the course of the season, he, or through his agent.
Right.
Articulated and explained that he did not want to be a Philadelphia Flyer.
Well, it could be that he actually visited Philadelphia.
Oh my God! Flyer alumni people who watch this thing. I speak there every March. I love that city.
You know what? It's a city of brotherly love. Here's the thing: there's some pretty tough neighborhoods.
No, I know that. I know that because I've been told that. I haven't been in them, and I totally get that. I don't know. Do you think that was the reason?
Oh, I
think Tortorella. I mean, it seems to be there was a combination, potentially, allegedly. You can go on and read 50 different things. Let's just go this way. I'm going to throw it over to you.
Sure.
So just tell me this, because this is the crutch of it all. The guy was drafted and in the first round, very high.
Yeah.
He's an incredible talent. The guy
was it eighth or something like that?
It's like sixth or seventh. Oh, okay. Yeah, eighth. Okay. Yeah. Top 10 for sure. And he got traded for a guy drafted sixth. Maybe that's where I'm getting confused, because Jamie Drysdale was drafted 26th overall. He's had some injury problems out of Anaheim. But by all accounts, if he can get healthy, he's going to be a bona fide starter. That's the thought. There was a second round pick came as well, because Gauthier, recency bias, is the guy driving the bus on this trade right now. But what's driving the trade is Daniel Briere, the Flyer GM, going public saying, well, the guy told us he didn't want to be here. And that's just absolutely inflamed the Flyer faithful.
Right.
Like they're ready just to decapitate him.
Well, and so
here's
two questions.
Yeah.
One, was that done to be inflammatory and to rile people up?
Yes.
Okay. Two, how badly did he not want to go there, and what were the issues? Maybe he's got a new girlfriend who lives in L.A.
Well, should that matter? Should you be able to...
Absolutely. Oh, absolutely.
What?
Well, listen, here's
disagree.
The thing. No, so I'm gonna disagree, because I think that when you become a professional athlete, okay, and you're being offered money, okay, you're being paid, okay, I get that, okay, but you also have an ability to self-determination, okay, and you know if you get drafted, you go somewhere. This is a very, and I'm gonna sound like Jennifer. bodily there. Yeah. This is archaic. But the fact of the matter is that owning somebody, okay, is okay. If the guy wants to take less money to go and sign with another city because that's better for him.
What's to stop everybody from doing it then?
That's right. What's to stop everybody
from doing it? Well, there's a draft. There's a process. There's a business. If you don't want to be in the business, go punch.
And you know what? And that's exactly where the NHL's headed. Because the NHL, and this is going to be a great segue, okay, to this ridiculous horseshit contract for Nylander. Okay? Way too much money.
Okay,
for
well, we'll get there.
But what it does is it sets a precedent. And so you're going to have all these guys making massive amounts of money, and then guys making the minimum, and the guys who are worth $5 million a year aren't going to have work because there's no room for them. And so these are great hockey.
Well, you know
players.
Where they go?
Yeah, they go to Europe.
No, you know where they go?
No.
They go on the teams that win the Stanley Cups.
Well, yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But see, the NHL is wrong. They've got to get with the times. Listen, I know this from, you know, from Evan when he was playing here. Okay, in minor hockey, it's more fucked than you can imagine.
Yeah.
Because
it's very restrictive.
Because of where he lives.
Yeah.
Okay? Because of where he lived, he had to play with the Ottawa Valley Titans, which practiced 5 days a week or 4 days a week in Beechburg.
Yeah.
Which was an hour and 45-minute drive one way.
Yeah,
ridiculous. To get there. So he didn't play.
Yeah.
Had he lived 800 meters from our house, he'd have been on the Nepean side, and it would have been a 10-minute drive.
Well, why did he just do what Steph Rawlings and all the guys did and just buy another home?
No, but the point of that is that
that's ridiculous.
Owning people based on your geographic... Like, he's a kid. They own him. And then, so you get drafted, and I get it. You get drafted, you go to a team, and you're very happy. And listen, if you get an opportunity to play in a city or play professional hockey, you're lucky.
Yeah.
However, okay, there has to be a point of self-determination for anybody in any profession. And hockey's got to recognize that. And so if you're...
That's never going to get recognized in hockey, other than if there becomes a preponderance of players who try to follow this. Well, all you're going to do is you'll see them shipped out. They'll be vilified by the teams that left them. But that's not... What do they care?
Exactly.
They're not going to care.
They play them twice a year.
They're going to sign their entry-level contract, big ticket. He looks like a blue chipper. And life's going to go on because the way the world works anyway, 4 to 8 hours later, any story right now is over pretty
that's
much.
Right. Yeah.
So this is hot-button topic right now, even when you post this. And
it'll be over by that point.
Probably, it'll have been down the depth chart for us to have brought it up initially. However, it was
that's why we got to have show some boobs. Okay. That's in my opinion, that's what keeps us relevant.
Yeah, I guess. Know? First of all, look at he didn't break any laws, any rules or anything. It's not like just because it's now gone public through the general manager of the Flyers means that the deal should have been rescinded or he has to automatically be a Flyer. Look what Eric Lindross forced out of Quebec City. He made such a colossal error. Had he gone to that city, had he even tried to learn 10 words in French, he would have been embraced by a culture that has hockey as a religion, as part of their dynamic.
But is that possibly why he did not?
No, he didn't do it, and everyone knows why. Because of his parents. His parents, how do you become brainwashed at 18 years of age to not like a city or a culture? You have to be told. How is any hate taught with children? And you grow into
it. You start young. Absolutely. If you're
it's with the parents.
You got to start young.
And I can't believe Gauthier is making this decision on his own either. At 18, you know, there's absolutely no doubt in my mind for whatever reason. I don't know anything about his parents. I know he's born in Sweden. I'm assuming his dad was playing pro hockey there. I don't even know. But I know this. He was born in Sweden, and the guy's all that. There's no doubt. At least right now, we'll see. Thousands of juniors gone to the show and not done anything.
So I
think it
clear.
Sucks.
Where was he born?
What? He's born in Sweden somewhere. What happened with him being drafted, saying he loved it, couldn't wait? What happened in 18 months?
That's right. So that's the question.
That's the question.
So you know what? There's more to the story.
Tortorella, maybe. It could very well be.
It could be, but you know what? It also could be as simple as a girl. Like honestly, like 18-year-old.
I cannot believe that. I guess maybe, but the way the world is today and the money these guys are making, he's walking right into minimum $800 American.
He's going to make that.
Not including signing bonus for 3 years. You know, it's ridiculous that that could possibly be the case. But I guess, Chris, I guess.
We don't know.
What I mean, there's a myriad of possibilities.
Okay, so I'm gonna end this right here.
Yeah, just, good enough.
On that, we covered that. But I want to say two things. Yeah, we don't know the answers, okay? But I like to make stuff up. Okay.
Okay.
So we'll start a rumor. I don't know what it's going to be, but we'll start a rumor as to what it was. I could be wrong.
Is Corey Perry involved somehow?
Corey Perry. It's because Corey Perry was going to Philly and apparently fucked his mom.
There you go.
That's the rumor that we're going to spread. You know what I mean?
I'll tell you what. There you go with our headline, and now we'll get another 3,000 views of Offside.
Exactly.
Because we've got this preponderous...
Titillating. Okay, so moving on to another discussion point. Okay.
Yeah.
I'll bring this up. So you didn't say anything about this, but I want to bring it up. The Professional Women's Hockey League.
Yeah.
I mentioned had their first game last time we had broadcast. Okay. And they've actually gone around, and the New York Toronto game got they got 2,300 people.
Where?
It was in Toronto. At
how many people?
2,300. It wasn't.
No. The highest attendance now. They blew Ottawa out of the water. Ottawa had over 8,000
really?
at the women's game. Okay. And then the Minnesota game had over 13,000. So that's the new record.
Okay, 13,000?
Yep, 13,100 or whatever it was. I didn't memorize.
So how long will that last is my question.
Not long. The numbers will drop, I believe. But I think it'll have some sustainability. You know, to be honest, Chris, I haven't watched a second of it as of yet. But as you know, my own personal story, getting set to close on my house and dealing with my mother and everything else. And when the hockey's on for me at night, man, I'm watching NHL. So, right. You know, I haven't had a chance, but I will. I'm going to
pull an eyeball. So you're not watching the chicks with sticks?
I'm not watching the chicks with sticks.
Now, can they use that as a marketing slogan?
I don't see why not. Although it's probably sexist, and some way they'll say it. And who knows, but
I said it. Well, we'll get letters.
Yeah, well, I will anyway. They seem to come to me, but that's fine. But look, Minnesota had over 13,000. At their game, at their women's game. So, there's six teams, and there's one here in Ottawa, which I think is fantastic, and they got a great showing. I think it's another week or 10 days for their next home game. We'll see. Maybe they'll sell it out again.
No, are they playing basically weekends? Is that their
I don't,
is that the model?
I haven't checked the schedule, but I believe it's a 24-game schedule, I want to say, and I think it's
probably weekends. I think that would be ideal, because then you could actually have a day job on top, because at the end of the day, let's face it, they're not making enough money.
Well, I think it's going to probably, hopefully, maybe get very quickly to where the CFL is, you know?
Right.
I don't know if they have, I don't know anything about the league. I don't know if they have a salary cap. I don't know. I should. I'm a hockey guy, but I haven't delved into the Professional Hockey Women's Association. But I wish them all well. I think it's great. Everybody is saying that they're hitting.
Yeah, well,
you know, there's been some hitting.
It's not,
I mean, they're not full on. That's still, I guess, supposed to be a penalty for a full on, like what we would classify as a body check. But
it's gritty. I kind of watched, not a whole game, but I watched segments of a couple of games. And
well, there you go.
You know, it's. I mean, it's not bad hockey. I mean,
no,
you know,
it's midget boy
it's
level not, is what it is. That's
yeah,
a, that's
it's not a, as good.
It's a level that they play at, and when they train, when the national teams play. And they play boys teams. The Canadian women, just the last couple of years for the Olympics and World Championships, they play Tier 2 Junior A teams.
Right.
And they usually lose about 6 or 7 to 1 or 8 to 1 or something. And but they love it. They absolutely love it. It is phenomenal practice. The Canadian women won't play any team as strong as a Tier 2 Junior boys team. And when they're playing the American women, and vice versa, the American women are training with boys teams as well.
Yeah.
And to get ready. So that's great. And they've moved up. You turn the clock back 10 years, they were playing peewee teams. You know? They've gone from peewee to midget, and midget teams that they were holding their own and starting to beat. These were club midget teams, not all-star teams or anything. And again, they were playing non-contact.
Right.
You know, you can't have can't have this midget age boys, 16, 7, 15, 16 out there,
hammering.
6'2", 6'3", running these girls over. But I mean, the hockey, the level, the quality is great that they're able to play in these games, and it prepares them for their world championships and their Olympics. Yeah. The league itself, look, they finally got the tumblers rolled over. They finally got it going.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah. No. And you know what? Time will tell. But I think it's I think it's a step in the right direction. And I think
100%.
I think it's great for young girls to be able to have.
For sure.
You know, and to have that dream. I mean, you know, I remember when they were younger girls, when Evan was playing, it's like, well, you know, where are they're going to get to play college hockey.
I coach girls too. The girls were on the boys team that my son Rory was on the first several years. One of them stayed right into Major Adam. Like, she went through IP, she went through novice and into Major Adam before she went. And she ended up playing university hockey in Montreal.
Yeah.
Okay, at McGill, I believe. Allison McKenzie, I believe. Mike McKenzie's daughter. And, in fact, one year she scored our first goal of the season. She played out. She played out and she was awesome, man.
Yeah.
She was awesome. Yeah, oh yeah. She was tough, too. And look, she went all the way to the Canadian university level.
Yeah. So, no, that's what I'm saying. But that was the epitome. College, like university or U.S.
or
U.S. college.
Unless you could get into a national program.
Now there's another level. Now there's the pro level where they can actually turn around and, you know, and not just make money on endorsements like Haley Wickenheiser, okay?
Yeah.
But be able to actually earn a little bit of money, not a lot, but a little bit of money playing a professional sport that they love.
Yeah.
I think it's actually fantastic.
Of course, there's no downside to this. There's nothing but positivity out of this. It's positive right across the board.
Yeah.
Everybody now is going to wait and see for the other skate to drop. Is it sustainable? And we're not going to know for a couple months. But
I think it'll last the first year, for sure. And it's what happens in year two. That's going to be the big thing.
Yeah.
I mean, I think there's enough momentum right now. And hopefully they can market. Maybe they'll get Gary Bettman to retire from the NHL and he'll take over that. And next thing, it'll be a 48-team league. You know.
Well, that'll be the sign for sure, is if it can grow, like you said, sustainability, financial, crowds, are people going to support it, sponsors. You know, so, I think people have tripped over themselves to sponsor it. They just announced a new sponsor the other day. So I think it's become the in thing, you know, in a good way. You know, I mean, it's just part of giving ladies it's the same opportunity without, obviously, they'll never, not in our lifetime, have the same remuneration possibilities. But, I mean, there's nothing negative about this.
Okay, so, and just before we end on that, the remuneration thing. I don't want to hear the argument from anybody that the women should be paid as much as the men, period.
No.
Because, and you know who said it? MMA fighter, what's her name?
Ronda Rousey. Yeah.
She said, someone asked her about that. She said, you know why I'm the highest paid fighter in the
UFC?
In the UFC? Because I bring in the most money.
Yeah.
That's what determines your value.
Yeah.
So if you bring in money, you're going to be paid accordingly.
That's correct. Yeah. So what it should be. Yeah.
Right. And that's why McDavid's and whatever, they make those big monies. Now, I'm going to jump on to the one thing that I started. I alluded to the fact that I thought it was a stupid contract.
Yeah.
Is Nylander.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, William Nylander signs a massive long-term deal worth essentially $11.5 million a year.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Lord only knows what the friggin' signing bonus outside of that was.
It's a $92 million contract. It's front end loaded. You get $39 million up front. It's lockout guaranteed. He's got a no move. He got the max, which is 8 years. He became, with the contract, the fifth highest paid player in the NHL, providing Pettersson, which most people assume in Vancouver will surpass him, it'll bump him down to sixth. And this is his first real year.
And I don't even see noise. I don't see him as the fifth or sixth best player in the league.
No, but you know, within 12 months, he'll probably be down to 10th or something, right? I mean, you got Marner's got to be re-upped, Draisaitl, Rantanen, Pettersson. These guys will probably.
And so, where does the money come from?
Well, comes from the owners of the teams,
right? But where do they get their money? They get it from the fans.
Yeah.
Who are paying this. I honestly, I don't even see that.
Well, fans have a choice. Don't you know, don't consume the product then.
And rightly so, when you're looking at, I was just talking to somebody who had gone to a game and they spent $240 a ticket.
I know.
And you're talking
about Toronto. This is a non-starter for conversation. It doesn't matter. Toronto fills the building anyway. Their fan base is a cult. It's a cult. The worst thing that could ever happen to Toronto would be for them to win.
It's all corporate.
Well, it is and it isn't. I mean, it is in the building, not outside the building. The product of the Toronto Maple Leaf brand that's consumed globally is obviously consumed outside.
You would think they were consuming like heroin at the same time.
Well, maybe. I mean, their fan base that every year that thinks they're going to win may as well be on heroin. If they think signing Nylander means they've got a better chance at the Stanley Cup, you may as well be just ingesting every drug imaginable. But I mean, the fact is that he was overpaid, but by how much?
I think by about $2 million.
Well, I think a million. I mean, the way he's playing this year, he's outstanding.
Think he's a $10 million guy?
I think definitely he's going to get 120 points this year, Chris. That's, you know, the general rule of thumb is it's $1 million a point, right? Or for 10 points, every 10 points is $1 million. It's sort of the general sort of rule of thumb in the NHL. Now, that means they're looking. Most general managers will say, "Yeah, show me that over 5 or 6 years." But this is the way the NHL works. His contract was up. He was going to be a free agent July 1st. They got ahead of it.
Yeah.
They got ahead of it. Look, I don't like the deal from the point of view of, I don't think they've done anything to enhance their chance to win the Stanley Cup. And, you know, and let's say, hypothetically, they go out again early this year, first or second round. And look, all but assuredly, they're playing the Florida Panthers in the first round. It's just a question of who's going to have home ice advantage. You can call it right now. You can call it right now. They're playing Florida Panthers first round.
All right. Well, there you go. There you have it, folks. Liam has predicted a Toronto Maple Leaf, Florida Panther first round matchup in the playoffs. Which leads me to bring up an idea that we have. And I want to hear from people. So we have our hockey pool for the regular season.
Yeah.
Okay, which is, and it's really heating up. Like it's
Hosey and Brown hockey pool.
The Hosey and Brown hockey pool.
Thank you, Hosey and Brown.
We're considering adding a playoff pool.
I think it's a fabulous idea.
Okay. But we need to make sure that we get enough people because this is going to be basically the prize lot is going to be driven by the participants.
Now, hold on a second. Are you going to announce what the potential prize may be?
Well, no, I'm going to announce that our goal is to add one more person to our trip to Ireland.
What?
Okay. But in order to do that, we need X amount of people because we already have our sponsorship. That's already done. We don't have any more money to spread around.
Yeah.
And this would drive that all the money, just as the first one, all the money goes towards the prize lot.
Why don't you
it's not a money-making thing for us.
Why don't we just do a refundable call to arms here, call to action call, and say we need, 250 people?
250 people would do
250
it.
250 people.
At $25.
Word has spread to so many people who are pissed off that they missed out on getting in our pool now that they know.
Well, I want to know about that because talk is cheap, right? You know, so we'll see with respect to that. Okay, now, another thing. We're going to actually take a break. We're going to come back because we're going to do a segment of Ask Liam. All right, we're back and welcome to this. This is the segment, as you know from the bumper that just came on, Ask Liam. So what we do is we ask Liam a trivia question. He doesn't know what this question is going to be, but I got it. So somebody asked me this question to ask you. So, and it's an Ottawa-related question.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. So there's a hockey player from Ottawa, born, I think, around the same time as you, Johnny Barrett.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So Johnny Barrett played, I don't know, like a dozen seasons in the NHL.
Yeah.
Bounced around a number of teams, right?
He played about 8 years in the NHL.
8 years?
79 to 87.
Okay. So he played 8 years in the NHL. Okay. And his first team was the Detroit Red Wings.
Right.
Okay. And in his welcome to the league, he got into a scrap. You like the fights.
Yes, I do. Okay.
The big question is who did he fight in his very first, because he fought, he was a tough guy.
He was.
Who did he fight in his very first fight in the NHL?
Was it New York Islander?
Should I be giving you these answers?
No. I think it was either Nystrom or Gillies.
Okay, so it was not Clark Gillies, but it was Bob Nystrom.
Bob Nystrom, okay. Yeah.
So here's the thing. Bubba owes me a beer. Okay.
Did Bubba give you that one?
Yeah. So Bubba just asked him that question because he always forgets.
Yeah.
I was like, so you got it. You got that question.
Good. Well, first of all, it's great that he owes you a pint. Here's the thing about John Barrett. He's the only man in NHL history. There's been a lot of guys playing in the NHL. He's the only guy in NHL history to punch every Sutter brother in the head.
Really? Well, that, you know what? That, see, there it is. There's the trivia that we need.
The trivia angle. That's how I always introduce him. Yeah. He played 488 games. He was tough as nails. He had about 90 fights, including playoffs.
Here's the next question. Yeah. Who was his last fight?
Oh, now that one I...
This is a good one.
Hold on. Was it Wendell?
No.
No?
No.
He
was a former teammate.
Former teammate. Okay. Wasn't Proby.
No.
Wasn't Kosher.
No.
But a Detroit teammate or a Washington teammate?
Detroit.
Okay.
He was with Washington.
He's with the Caps. Because his last NHL team was the Minnesota
North Stars. Yeah.
Actually, he only played there one shift. That was a scam. That's a long story. Not a long story, but it's a story. Let me think. With the Caps, former teammate. So a Red Wing.
He was with the Caps.
He was with the Caps. He fought a Red Wing. So a teammate of his. I don't know, so I'm guessing. It's not Turkey. It's not Glant, is it?
It is Glant.
Yeah, Glant. Turkey Glant?
Yes.
There you go.
Yeah.
Okay. So, yeah.
But,
another tough customer. I mean, Johnny only fought tough guys. He's legit, just like his brother, Freddie. Freddie had a few fights, too. I mean, he fought Fergie, he fought Paul Holmgren. They both fought Paul Holmgren, but both Barretts. But Paul was a beast. But Johnny was more of a fighter than Freddie, but. Freddie played over 700 games. Johnny played almost 500. I mean, almost 1,300 games between them.
That's a lot.
Very impressive. That's,
you know what?
Very impressive.
We get excited about a guy who goes and even has coffee.
I know.
Right?
I know.
And so to be there.
Yeah.
Because you had asked me about Johnny Barrett last week, and that's what actually kind of got me thinking about things like that. And then we were just chatting the other day.
Him and Bubba have an interesting backstory because of an incident at the RA Center.
I understood. And you were behind the bench.
I was.
Yeah, I heard that. We can't tell that here because we're done with Ask Liam. We're fucking through with it.
Okay.
We're moving on.
That's probably a good idea.
All right.
Because I get pretty upset.
Yeah. So the next thing we're going to talk about, though, is you have said, you have purported to want to take over the reins of the Puck Bunny Zamboni Boy franchise for a little while to try and prove something to me that the broads that I chose were, you know what I mean?
No, you only had a couple that were out of left field. Most of the ones you had, I don't know. But it's I have one.
Okay. Yeah. So we're going to come back with our Puck Bunny of the Week. I really, 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 really like girls. Yeah, I really, really, really. Hey, welcome back for the Puck Bunny of the Week. I am handing over the reins of Puck Bunny aficionado or I don't even know what you're doing as this, and Zamboni Boy to Liam to see if he can, we'll just see how he does compared to my choices. Okay? Liam.
Well, where am I starting? Boy or the girl?
Well, let's start with Puck Bunny.
Okay.
You got it.
Well, I didn't go too far out in the limb, Chris. Julia Roberts. But I think she's a worthy choice on a lot of fronts. For one, the first few that you did, especially a couple say that I didn't really know who they were, but they were beautiful women. There's no doubt about that. Julia Roberts is a beautiful woman.
She is. Yeah. She's all right. Yeah. She gets by.
Okay. Well, to me, you know, I have now picked one of my favorites.
Is she one of your favorites?
Yes, she is. Absolutely.
Really?
Yeah. She's one of my favorites for sure. I love her as an actress. I think she's absolutely stunningly beautiful, but I also really legitimately love her as an actress. She's kind of, maybe, I don't know. I mean, I don't care. You know, I can admire a girl or a woman of any age if they're in a public figure. I'm okay to say, yeah, that's a beautiful woman. She does happen to be closer to our age, I mean, she's a 67 birth.
Right.
So,
so as opposed to Wonder Woman, who's in her 70s now. Is that what you're saying?
Well, no, because we've had a couple of younger ones, haven't we? No, maybe not. Well,
most of, no, I've no, been, mostly, like, I've been yeah. pretty tasteful.
Yeah,
like,
you haven't really robbed the cradle at all, which is shocking. But Julia Roberts is a Georgia peach.
Yeah.
She's born in Georgia. And you know, her brother's Eric Roberts. And yeah. she's won every...
Now, you want to talk fine actors.
Yeah. Well, he's more of a... situational actor.
Well, you know what? See, there's an A list, there's a B list.
Yeah.
Okay. And then there's the, I don't even know what list Eric Roberts is on, but his daughter is Emma Roberts.
Emma, okay.
Emma Roberts, and she's like a genuine A lister, as they say.
Okay. Well, there you go. So, I mean, I know it's in the family, and in that sense, I mean, they certainly came by it honestly. Julia went to college, quit, went to New York. You know, had the looks, got into modeling, and was studying acting, and very quickly got some work in the 80s, and things took off. I mean, there isn't anybody watching that hasn't seen one of, like, Pretty Woman. Everybody has seen.
Well, yeah, I mean, but you Pretty know, Woman is...
Pelican Brief. I mean, there's so many films that she was in that were signature yeah. films. I mean, she's won every award as well. Like, yeah. this isn't just somebody who made it just on her looks and... did something, not to say that Farrah, who we had on, wasn't yeah. a great actress. I think she, like, you know, she did some stuff post Charlie's Angels that showed her acting chops.
That Burning Bed one.
The Burning Bed, probably yeah. the one she was most critically acclaimed for. But Julia Roberts, there's just no second guessing that the woman's a fantastic actress. Just watch her stuff. Erin Brockovich was an outstanding yeah. movie. You know, like Pretty Woman. Like, that's the thing. I mean, she can look the part. You need someone to dress up and look absolutely stunningly gorgeous. She could do that. But she can go out there and absolutely kill a scene or kill a movie. And she has. And she's won everything. So she's my pick for the Puck Bunny of this okay. particular
now
show.
Now you got to find the sexy pictures of her.
Oh,
okay, for posting.
Well, that's okay. easy, man. That's that's a 9-second Google. Boom.
Well, okay,
send them over to you and put them up. Come okay, on. If I had done that, I would have done that earlier today. I totally forgot about it. I just figured you'd go on Google and grab the 10 hottest pics of her or whatever.
Well, okay, all right. I'm just saying, I want to see some cleavage. That's all.
Well, Erin Brockovich. I mean, that she, you know, I mean, she even alludes to it in the movie, right? I mean, her acting in that was just so... And that's based on a true story, as everybody knows. And I just thought that may have been her best performance. But, you know, the Pelican Brief with Denzel Washington, he was a previous Zamboni boy of
theirs. That's right.
And one of my favorite actors. And I anytime that movie comes on, if I'm flipping through and it's on, I watch it.
Yeah.
I watch it. I love it. It's just a great flick. It's a great story. And a lot of the other actors that are and actresses that are in it, you know, there's a lot of people that we all know. So it's just a great flick. So I think Julia Roberts, you know, she's a great pick for the Puck Bunny.
All right, this week's Puck Bunny, Julia Roberts.
I really, 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 really like girls. Yeah, I really, really.
And now, we're going to jump over to Zamboni Boy.
He was a skater boy, she said see you later boy, he wasn't good enough for her.
Alright, we're back and Liam is going to choose the Zamboni Boy. I'm very nervous about what this is going to be because Liam's idea of the leadership qualities of man have a lot to do with violence.
What? I am shocked and flabbergasted at the accuracy of that statement. You just are very, very lucky that you guessed that because our Zamboni boy today, Chris, happens to be none other than the number one ranked of all-time pugilist in NHL history, Bob Probert.
Number one of all of the great pugilists?
Yeah. There isn't a single person worth their weight in hockey pucks that has ever had an inclination to be a fan of or has followed the game and understands the value and the knowledge, has knowledge of hockey fighting that does not have Bob Probert on the all-time list. More importantly, his peers have him on the all-time list. And I know because I've interviewed almost every single one of them. He had over 300 fights. He fought over 100 guys. I've probably interviewed 70 of them that he's fought. And to a man, they anoint him as the number one hockey fighter of all time. He's born in Windsor, drafted 46th overall in 83, same draft where the Red Wings got Yzerman and Joey Kosher. And him and Kosher formed the Bruise Brothers. I know it was the Bruise Brothers in Philly as well with Dave Brown and Daryl Stanley, but they weren't Proby and Kosher. Any fight Proby lost, as a Red Wing, he avenged. He lost a few, but he avenged them all. He stayed in the game with Chicago. You know, he had all the trouble, right? Smuggling cocaine across the border. He got suspended. He was in jail. He was in rehab.
He didn't smuggle it.
Oh, yeah, because he got caught, I guess. Yeah, so he didn't really get that smuggling part done. You know, I had the great pleasure to work with him a few times. And I picked him up at the airport one time here in Ottawa, and I was taking him to his hotel. He was staying at the Brook Street, so it was quite a drive from the airport. We chatted the whole way, and I said, Bob, you know, you've fought so many guys, and you fought a ton in junior too, and you fought a friend of mine in junior. You fought him five times, and I'm sure you'll never, he didn't make the NHL. There's probably no way you'll remember. Yeah, what's his name? I said, Joel Brown. He went, oh, Toasterhead. Yeah, I remember him. Well, he was tough as nails. Yeah, he cut me one night. I was pissed off. And then he went into the whole background of his fights with Joel. And I just thought that was absolutely amazing. There's a firefighter who lives in Greeley, Grant Anderson, was teammates with Bob and Junior and in Brantford, I think. And Grant's pretty tough, too. That's another story with Bubba. But anyway, Bob Probert, to me, he is a Zamboni guy. He's the greatest fighter in the history of the National Hockey League. He was 6'3 and a half, went about 218, 220, 222 at the end with Chicago. And, you know, he stayed in the game too long as a fighter, but he never turned down. This is the thing that Wendell Clark told me. He said, you know what, Liam, because Wendell fought him like four or five times, right? And he got hurt bad fighting Bob. Like, he got the better of Bob. You could make the case that in that first fight, he got the better of Bob Probert, but he paid for it. Like, in a subsequent fight with Probert, the one where he really ragdolled him, that's when Wendell hurt his back. He hurt his back in that fight because Bob was dragging him like he was a ragdoll, right? And, but Wendell said, Liam, you know what I admired about him the most was even at the end of his career, 99, 2000, whatever, he's fighting all the guys that are coming in the league, the Darren Langdons, the George Laracs, the Jody Shelleys. Like, he fought Jody Shelley five times, I think, in 48 hours. He fought him every period of a game. So fought him every period.
So let me ask you this, and because here's the thing. Bob Probert had hockey skill as well.
Yeah, he made the All-Star game in 1988. He had 29 goals one year. He had over 60 points. He had a bunch of seasons of 40-plus points. He's fifth overall in career penalty minutes, 3,330. He scored the last goal ever in Maple Leaf Gardens, in February of 99 when he was a member of the Chicago Blackhawks, which is just a really cool anecdote. He got the Red Wings to the semifinals in back-to-back years. He set the record. He set the record for the most points. The most points by a Detroit Red Wing in one playoff year. He broke Gordie Howe's record.
So
it's since question, been broken by Fedorov, but Bob Probert held that record with 21 points.
So my question is that wasn't there a point where he could have just said, like Gordie Howe, tough as nails, you didn't mess with him. Couldn't he have transitioned into tough as nails, I'm not fighting, I want to score my 30 goals a season?
He may have been able to move the pendulum a little bit more that way. However, in that era, in his prime, in the 80s and 90s, as you well know, Chris, even though the instigator rule came in, the instigator rule came in 1976, but it wasn't really called with any regularity until Gil the Thrill Stein reinforced it with a game misconduct in 91, which Gary Bettman rescinded in 1993. Bob Probert, I don't think, felt he was in a position that he couldn't answer the bell for any perceived or real transgression on the ice, and which is what he did with Detroit. Of course, when the trouble happened with the law, he came back with Detroit, got in more trouble, ends up going to Chicago. We know the story. But the bottom line is that, no, I don't think he could have gone the way that most, a lot of, not all, but a lot of enforcers did have to eventually take their foot off the gas. It was either due to physical restrictions or lack of wanting to get into a war every third night, or just of how their ability was eroding for all of those reasons. But having said that, Bob's willingness and want to go never diminished. He's never a guy that even after he got out of the game and before his untimely death, and I want to finish on that note in a second, but before his death, and he was in the process of finishing up his memoirs there when he did pass away, he never said that he regretted it like Dave Schultz has now. Dave Schultz has gone public and said, I wish I wasn't that guy. I wish I didn't fight like that and this, that, everything else. Dave, you know, whatever, whatever. I admire Dave. I respect him. I've worked with him many times. He's going to be on the stage with me in 2 months in Philadelphia, and he's going to be applauded by 500 people going nuts as soon as he walks on because he's a freaking hero for how he played in the mid-70s. But, you know, now he looks back and he makes that statement, and I go, Jesus Christ. Like, Dave, how can you possibly look back now and say that when you ran roughshod over the league? I mean, he was the most scared guy. Everybody was so fearful of him. Yeah, Clark Gillies, Larry Robinson, blah, blah, blah. But 90% of the league, they got the Philly flu. They didn't want to go in there because of the Broad Street Bullies, of which he led. Now he comes out 40 years, 50 years later and says, I wish I wasn't that guy. I wish I didn't fight like that. Proby never said that.
Right.
Never said it. No, Chris, to answer your question, he could not, he would not, he did not say that. And I'm glad he didn't. I feel it would have tarnished his image. The end of the day, he came in an era when it had proliferated to its highest degree, when every single team needed not one. You better have two. You needed at least two guys, that were good to go, dropping the gloves and good to go. That New York Islander team that won four cups in a row, five straight finals, 19 consecutive playoff series. There is no team in NHL history. I'm saying this as a Hab fan. You're a Bruin fan, and your big bad Bruins don't take a backseat to many.
No.
But that Islander team, Chris, in the early 80s, they had more players on their roster ready to go, willing to go, able to go, than any other cup-winning team in history. There was no other cup-winning team in that respect than the New York Islanders in the early 80s. That was the era. I'm not saying it now that, look, that's how you win today, despite how Florida played in the playoffs last year and ran everybody out of Dodge till by simple attrition, they had nothing left for Vegas.
Right.
But the bottom line is, Bob Probert is an outstanding pick by me as a Zamboni boy today with 3,330 penalty minutes. He sits fifth overall. He's one of only nine guys with over 3,000. He had over 300 fights in the NHL. And I'll finish on this note. He died of a heart attack. He had heart failure. Yeah, they donated his brain and they found some CTE. You know what? You could probably find some in my brain right now. The bottom line is that he died of a heart attack and heart failure that thousands upon thousands upon thousands of other men and women die from. And who knows how much of a factor maybe the cocaine or the drugs or anything else played in his life. He didn't die. He didn't commit suicide. He didn't overdose. He was living his best life when he passed away and on that boat with his wife and his family. You can imagine how tragic that must have been for them to have to witness. And he is still revered to this day, number 24 of the Detroit Red Wings. Bob Probert is our pick as the Zamboni boy on Offside with Haas and McGuire. G'day.
All right, we're back, and we're going to close on something today. It was inevitable to happen, and you know we were just talking about enforcement. Let me try that with an English word.
Easy for you to say, Chris.
Enforcement. Okay. So
English
Connor
is a
Bedard,
second language in Coniston, folks.
That's right. Connor Bedard, injured, broken jaw, out for probably a couple of weeks, and then he'll come back with a mask or something. But
I suppose, yeah.
You know,
fractured jaw. It's badly fractured. I don't know. I think it'll be more in a couple of weeks.
Okay,
what do you think about
the incident itself?
Yeah.
And what do you think about the aftermath or lack thereof?
Yep. Well, my take is a totally clean hit. You can watch it a million times on slow motion. Connor's reaching for the puck. Smith's standing right there. I mean, he almost like, I mean, he does nothing. He just literally stands right there, embraces, and Connor takes the bulk of it, comes right here. I don't see there was any, there was no elbow, there was nothing, there was no maliciousness, no intent, absolutely nothing. Connor's a much smaller guy, stepped in, overstepped, got hit, and got hurt. The response from Foligno and the Blackhawks, I have zero problem with either because...
But it wasn't huge.
No, it wasn't, but, you know...
But it was a response that you would expect. But it didn't turn into a melee.
No, it didn't, because I think now, with the tablets on the benches, and I mean, look, even Luke Richardson, the head coach of Chicago post-game, said he thought it was a clean hit. That's coming from Connor's own coach.
Right.
I mean, Connor will be the first guy, whenever he does make a statement on it, when he connects talk, he'll say the same thing. There's zero doubt in my mind. Yeah, I had it on our list of notes today. I know we're a few days past it all and everything else. I just threw it out there because, obviously, for 48 hours, it was the topic.
Oh,
it was the topic. And again, you know, it's all the left-wing tree huggers out there just thinking that Smith should be throwing right out of the league and, you know, and that it's just a hit that can't happen. I said it's a hit that was unavoidable. Like, well, it just there's no way you could avoid that
hit. I spoke about this before. Like, we talk about guys who are bigger, guys who are, and that whole leaning forward, leaning in, and the headshot piece, right?
Yeah.
I mean, you know what I mean? That's one of the challenges that we have in the modern game.
Yeah.
Okay. Is that. And I'm not a big fan of, I mean, sure, if somebody deliberately goes for a headshot, but there's got to be, you know, and in this case there was, but there's got to be some common sense in the assessment of penalties / you know, going over things. I think, you know what?
Listen,
it's unfortunate for the poor kid.
It is. And listen, you're just touching on something. I know we got to shut her down here, but the Cousins, who was vilified by Bieksa on Hockey Night in Canada, I think rightfully so.
I said the same thing.
Yeah, yeah. As a matter of fact, you did. So kudos to you. You absolutely did, and good on you. And I thought that was great. Don't see that very often highlighted on mainstream media to that extent, especially HNIC, which is still a big player in our game. Even though now, you know, we're dependent.
Well, but, it's you know what? Listen, it's not quite Offside with Hos McGuire.
No, I mean, listen, but, that starts from there and then moves down like the Spit and Chicklets and some other of the smaller ones.
Yeah. But,
but you know what? They can run all the hockey pools they want. They don't have the winner go to Ireland like
That's
we do.
Right. That's true.
So, yeah, I mean, it's good on it to highlight Cousins, who's the type of guy who's come in and has picked up the mantle from like a Matt Cook or a Cal Clutterbuck on the Islanders as a rep for it, or you go back like a Steve Webb.
Well, I wouldn't say Clutterbuck.
Not so much Clutterbuck, but
is like Matt Cook. I think
that's a great line with Siddiqui. I
like Clutterbuck. I think he's
running around and hit some guys cheap too. But Cousins is Matt Cook's the worst.
Matt Cook was the worst. You know what I mean? And I don't know the guy, and I know that you have
Sean Avery.
You don't like him?
No, I hate him.
So Sean Avery wasn't necessarily, he was an asshole.
Yeah.
And he had a lot of fun doing the shit that he did.
He didn't do what Matt Cook did. I know where you're going.
And everybody loves Avery.
Well.
So many guys go, fuck, Avery was so fun.
And his teammates
did. And half the things that he did were,
You know, he came within like 3 games of getting his name on the Stanley Cup. If he had played 3 or 4 more regular season games
in that
Detroit Red Wings in, I think it was 2002, if he had played 3 or 4 more games, he would have played enough regular season games because he didn't play in the playoffs. He would have played enough regular season games to get his name on the cup, but he didn't. But everywhere he went, there's a lot of stories. Anyway, I don't know. He's living his best life, as they say, in New York. He's doing a bunch of stuff, and he seems to be enjoying life.
Has he got a podcast?
I don't know. He's got something online because he's posts some stuff, and it's just, of course, he's Sean Avery, so he's, you know, he gets it, you know, one click of the switch, he's got a gajillion people.
Right.
You know, so.
Well, we should call him.
Yeah.
Because here's the thing. I only hear good things about him, to be honest with you. As a guy, I know that
not
playing,
me.
He was annoying. Really?
Yeah, no. I've heard some pretty reprehensible stuff about him, actually.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, so I heard he was
pretty. I heard some stuff in Los Angeles between him and Dustin Brown, and some of the things that happened in the dressing room, actually, was pretty reprehensible. So.
Oh, really?
Now, having said that, this is a long time ago, And when Sean's in the, you know, in, well into his career, just doing Sean Avery type stuff. I mean, this is kind of akin to him and Marty Brodeur, which was, you know, basically they made the rule, you know, that you can't do that after he, that whole incident with Brodeur. But I mean, among the many other things that he did.
That was funny though.
You know, the incident with Dion Phaneuf.
The Phaneuf thing, you know what, you know what?
Well, it's because it went public, you know, the whole story got out there, so you kind of had to. You know,
well, no, but he took it public. That was the problem.
Yeah.
This sloppy seconds comment was like, you know. No, but that just goes to show, I mean, I don't know the details or whatever, but I mean, and she's a beautiful lady, but she could be a puck bunny, by the way. Cuthbert.
Absolutely.
You know, and which, by the way.
I'll pick next week's too.
When he was in Ottawa, I know some folks who knew him and her.
Yeah.
And nicest people around.
Yeah.
I heard great things about them and her especially, that she was just a sweetheart. You know, and I'm just going from that.
Yeah, yeah, fair. Know. Hey, listen, but, that's way more inside info than I have. I have never talked to anybody who knows her or I have never interviewed Sean Avery or anything else or whatever. So it is what it is. You're right. He wasn't Matt Cook and Cook and like just say cousins, whatever. But, I just thought, given the road we were going down, that there was nothing dirty about the hit on Connor Bedard, and you're right. The response from Chicago was expected. It was proper, and it was measured.
That's right.
And like Foligno's an old school warrior now at this point. I mean, he started here in Ottawa. Anybody here in Ottawa probably remembers his time in the Senators and. Guy's an honest, hard-nosed guy. Guy comes by it honestly. His brother Marcus, same way. Their dad, Mike. Yeah. And so, you know, he got some great synergy there. Northern Ontario, Mike Foligno.
Sudbury,
yeah. Boy. Yeah. Everything comes back to you in Northern Ontario. Right. Yeah. I swear to God, it's unbelievable.
Yeah.
What are you going to tell anybody about next week?
No, or? We're not. We're not saying anything. But but we will be saying that we have some special shit happening in the future that is going to be, to be honest with you, it's going to be international. I believe it could even be global for the importance
part of
the importance of what we're going to be
doing. If we get what we want out of next week, I think we're definitely going to blow the doors wide open on Offside with Hawes and McGuire.
Oh, absolutely.
Minimum.
There's not a question. I mean, you know what? It's giving us an opportunity to show. It's more than just beyond our great personalities and good
luck. And me drinking beer because he's on dry January.
Dry
or some
January. I'm still dry. So
can you not get a mulligan? Because
what I'm thinking of doing is taking a pause.
Yeah.
Right. Is a pause.
Do I have to sign something? Or?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Yeah. There'll be a few things you're gonna be have to a waiver.
A waiver. You sign a waiver.
That's
and I'm gonna quickly feed it to the alligators.
So we're gonna do an episode, probably by the night on the 19th hole of some golf course in Florida.
It's gonna be crazy.
And so that's why the gator comment. So we will be there shooting a quick episode down in Florida. Stay tuned. That's gonna be epic. It's gonna be awesome. It's gonna be. You know what? You know what I think? I think maybe we should go and pop into Mar-a-Lago.
Yeah.
Pop in. We'll see if we can. We'll pop into Mar-a-Lago, and I don't know if we can. But I know a guy. I should send him a note. I know a guy who knows.
Who knows a guy?
Who knows a guy?
Yeah.
You stay tuned next week, live from Florida. It's gonna be Offside with Hawes and McGuire. I happen to be Hawes.
I'm McGuire. G'day.